I'm reading from www.revolutioninreligion.com. An article called The Nazarene. The following is excerpted from Dr. Husfeldt's forthcoming book, The Greatest Lie Ever Told, a manifesto for a religious revolution and a new consciousness. Since I have been in the presence of angels, he goes on, I can give you some slight insight into these otherworldly beings. I can verify as correct the knowledge that two assisting angels always accompany an archangel, as this was the case with the visitation that I received. In addition, there are four commonly known primary archangels. They are Michael, Raphael, Gabriel, and Uriel. Of these four, Michael is the only one that I can personally verify. This is the man speaking. I can also verify one thing that I know is not possible, and this is the ability to channel, as many New Age channelers claim, angels, or especially archangels. Pure and simple, this concept is an affront to the power and majesty of these awesome, otherworldly beings. Besides these four archangels, and according to tradition, there are a multitude of other angelic beings classified within nine celestial orders. These nine orders are divided into three triads, with the highest order known as seraphim and the lowest as angels. The most interesting of the nine are the seraphim, winged serpents, popularly known as the fiery flying serpents of lightning, who roar like lions when aroused. The seraphim are more identified with the serpent or dragon than any other angelic order. In fact, the Jewish priest translated the word seraphim into Greek as drakon, from which we get our word for dragon. For many ancient and current spiritual traditions, the serpent dragon has symbolized wisdom, enlightenment, and immortality. For many people of the past, the serpent and shaman were one and the same, representing the wisdom of earth and heaven. But this was not the case for the Christians of Paul and the Christian church. Under the dictates of the church, the serpent became demonized as being representative of some Satan. This was visually demonstrated by the church in its imagery of the Virgin Mary trampling the serpent underfoot. In addition, the serpent in many cultures represented the feminine wisdom of the earth, and clearly, through patriarchal dictate, the transforming, life-giving, and affirming wisdom of the serpent was turned into a symbol of ultimate evil. We must keep in mind that Yeshu was Jewish. Hebrew and Judaism had a close relationship with the serpent, dating back from the fiery bronze serpent that Moses raised in the desert to heal the Israelites. Numbers 21:9. In point of fact, Yeshua is often referred to as being from a town called Nazareth, Jesus of Nazareth. This may or may not have been true, however, it is a fact that he was connected with an esoteric sect called the Nazarenes. Therefore, it would be proper for him to be addressed as Jesus the Nazarene, Yeshua the Nazarene. Many authors have argued that Nazarene was not just one term that was used, but the dominant term, and that it was also used to describe Yeshua himself. The chief argument for this claim rests on an interpretation of the way Yeshua is referred to by the writers of the Gospels. The original Greek forms of all four Gospels call him in places Yesu Nazaren. Translations of the Bible from the 5th century Vulgate on have generally rendered this into a form equivalent to Yeshu of Nazareth. However, it is not the only possible translation. Linguistically, Yeshu, the Nazarene, would be at least as correct, and some critics have argued that it is more plausible, given that the city of Nazareth seems to have not existed at the time of Yeshua. It is unmentioned in any contemporary history, and it is not possible to prove its early existence than by reference to the Gospels. Nazarene comes from the root word Nazar, referred to sanctifying oneself to the service of God. Nazar is closely rendered etymologically to Nahash, Hebrew for serpent, and Neshama, or soul in Hebrew. The Nazarenes were an esoteric sect connected or closely aligned with the Essenes. During this period of time, there were three primary philosophical sects of Judaism: the exoteric Pharisees and Sadducees, and the esoteric Essenes. As is usually the case, any esoteric belief system is a threat to the primary and more commonly accepted exoteric systems. It is easy to see why this is the case. In exoteric paradigms, the everyday materialistic consciousness is given total validity as the only true state of mind. Higher states of consciousness or intuition are not considered valid nor real. Furthermore, in esoteric systems, people question. They question dogma, doctrine, and anything written that is supposedly literal truth. But exoteric paradigms do not want questions, only blind obedience to their system of belief. Esoteric followers are usually branded as cultish in a derogatory manner, heretics, and revolutionaries. In first century Judea, the Essenes were not the only esoteric cult or sect. There were the Nazars or Nazarenes, a branch of the Essenes, and even offshoots of the Nazars, Gnostics, and others that were more or less Kabbalistic in the eyes of the Jewish ruling elite. These sects were heretical and troublesome. We might think that Judea was isolated and only teeming with Romans, but that was not the case. There were many others from varying cultures and belief systems, such as Buddhist missionaries who had overrun Egypt, Greece, and even Judea, and who influenced the Essenes. In addition, there was a Babylonian and Chaldean influence. The Jewish scriptures indicate two distinct worships and religions among the Israelites. Two distinct worships and religions among the Israelites. That of Bacchus worship under the mask of Jehovah, and that of the Chaldean initiates, to whom belonged some of the Nazars, the Theurgists, and a few of the prophets. We have now arrived at a point in our investigation of truth where things begin to get interesting. One of the physical traits of a Nazar was their long hair. Supposedly, this identifying mark extended as far back as the long-haired Nazar Samson and the prophet Elijah. Yeshua was also long-haired, but he was not what you would call a strict Essene or Nazarene, as he ate all kinds of food, often drank wine, and enjoyed life. Dogmatic doctrine, whether it is from an exoteric or even an esoteric secret tradition, is still dogmatic and doctrinal. In other words, both are not paradigms of equality open to all people. Sometimes the esoteric sects are as close-minded and prohibitive as the exoteric ones, and this is what Yeshua discovered and rebelled against. Not only were the orthodox sects more concerned with rules and regulations than natural law, so were the esoteric sects. Yeshua was a Nazarene and had been initiated.